Hi everyone. Happy Sunday. Hope you can hear me okay. Got the AC running overtime. It's pretty hot here in Northern Virginia. Anyway, I was thinking about something, and it kept coming up a couple times, so I figured I really kind of had to share this with everybody. I found myself writing down, slow and steady wins the race, or at least can sustain you for the long haul. And I wrote that down a couple days ago because I was feeling very overwhelmed, just with all the stuff that I have to do. I think a lot of you know that my son has a task list to take care of before he goes off to the United States Merchant Marine Academy in less than 2 weeks, and it's been an aggressive timeline to get all these things taken care of. And you know, I have my own things going on, and it's a lot. And I was feeling a little overwhelmed with some tasks that I had on my to-do list that kept hanging on my to-do list, so I wasn't checking them off my to-do list. So I found myself thinking about that. Slow and steady wins the race, or at least can sustain you for the long haul. So you've got that endurance going for you there. So, you know, it's not a marathon, it's not a sprint, it's more like a marathon, slow and steady. And then I came across something this morning that just kind of solidified that whole theme for me. I had to write it down so I didn't forget it. Confucius says, it does not matter how slowly you go as long as you do not stop. And I thought, that's very fitting too. And also, I'd have to caveat that with, as long as you start. So it doesn't matter how slowly you go as long as you start. And that's what I found myself kind of challenging myself to do yesterday with my task list for my business. I had a lot of outstanding, I needed to update my website and just, you know, some programs that I'm working on creating. And I've this task list almost as long as what my son has to do before he goes to the academy. And I was just overwhelmed. Like, where do I even start? I have a list of, you know, top priorities, but oh my God, it was just actually starting I was finding the challenge. So again, it doesn't matter how fast I'm going through those things. We all have our own time, our own timeline, I would say, to get things done. And, you know, a lot of times we tell ourselves really dangerous words like, you need to do this, you should be doing this, you shouldn't do this, and you have to do this. And those kind of are not motivating words at all. I'd have to say that they're demotivating, if anything. And then they just kind of add more pressure to yourself when you say those words. So I personally tried to eliminate them from my vocabulary, and I hope you don't catch me saying any of them when I'm live on these Facebook Lives. But I found that the best way to actually beat overwhelm is simply to start doing one little task at a time. And so yesterday I knocked a whole bunch out, and I'd have to say, but it took me several hours, and I needed that block of time, which has been very challenging to find, you know, 3 or 4 hours of time that I can just sit down and focus. But after I got through a large part of my to-do list, I was like, I felt good. And don't you feel good when you finally buckled down, stopped procrastinating, and stopped feeling so overwhelmed? And I can say that, you know, methodically working through my task list, I felt empowered too. I felt very empowered, and that I was jogging my way through it. And that's another thing. I noticed that, and this is along the same lines, and it kind of veers off into another point that I think that a lot of people might benefit from hearing, is that, you know, when I was doing my 5 mile run on the treadmill yesterday, I had about 54 minutes, because I've sped up my pace, got my time down a little bit, but I had a lot of time to think. And monotonous thinking. So, you know, I'm watching other people in the gym, and I had this thought, like, well, what if they're looking at me? Because, you know, we all think that people are looking at us when they're probably not, and they're, you know, we're more worried about themselves. But I thought, what if people are looking at me saying, gosh, she's pretty slow. Shouldn't she be running faster by now? Again, they're probably not even thinking about what I'm doing, but being self-conscious, I think about these things. And I thought, you know, first of all, we all have our stories, and we all have a starting point. You know, if they're at the gym, they had a starting point too. They weren't just born in the gym, right? Or they weren't born on a treadmill running. They had to start somewhere. And that's the point, starting somewhere. And I remember just, I'd say back in December, I was not running. I was still doing an uphill climb, trying to drop some more weight so that it was easier on my joints. And I was not ready to run. And as a long distance runner who'd run, you know, 10 milers and a half marathon and things like that, and 5 miles was like not a big deal, that was eating humble pie for me. But I had my degenerative disc disease issues in my back that I was trying to recover from, and, you know, a whole bunch of other physical issues, my blood pressure. So I had to take it slow, but I started, and I stayed consistent, and I kept showing up. And that's another thing, keep showing up. So, you know, going back to that whole thing about, you know, everybody has their own story and where they start from, it kind of drives the point home again of we are our own competition, not our biggest competition. We're our own competition, because how can you possibly compete with somebody who doesn't have the same history or the same experience or the same physical composition as another person? You really can't. So, you know, with the running, I compete with myself. I try to be better than I was last week, picking up my time, you know, kind of having a little competition with myself. And it's healthy. It's healthy that way. And that way I can keep the focus on myself. And the other thing I found is when, you know, I keep track of my times and how, you know, my heart rate and all of that stuff, so that I can gauge it, how my improvement. And so I'll look back over, you know, the past couple months and be like, oh, wow. So my heart rate's improved, keeping track of the metrics to really gauge improvement is very empowering. So, you know, I do that. And then, you know, with, you know, just daily tracking of my to-do list, I find myself, you know, scratching things off so that and then at the end of the week, thinking about how I felt when I accomplished all these things. I still, you know, this morning I asked my son, do you have anything to put into the memory jar? Because we have a jar that we have little pieces of colored paper, and, you know, whenever we write down something that we'd like to remember as an accomplishment, we stick it in the jar. And on, you know, New Year's Day or, you know, sometime around New Year's, we'll open the jar as a family and look through the past year of, oh my gosh, all the wonderful things that we've accomplished little by little. I mean, they may not seem like a big deal at the time, but these things accumulate. And it's wonderful to be reminded of something that we forgot, you know, because it happened back in February or March of the previous year, and then be reminded of it several months later. And I think that's so important to keep the motivation going when you look at your accomplishments, and that you were competing against yourself, and you showed up and you did what you said you were going to do. You honored that commitment to yourself to you know, get through your to-do list, or, you know, get a workout in, or whatever it is that you're trying to accomplish. But so to recap, it does not matter how slowly you go, as long as you do not stop, or as long as you start. Confucius and Kim. So, I hope that resonates with somebody. Feel free to reach out and tell me what you think. And again, happy Sunday. Take care. Talk to you soon.